that sound great. We can keep it going. You know what that sound is? That sound is really common. Oh man, you can hear it even when you're turning back there. What you heard back there is very common with carbon ceramics on street vehicles. The reason for this is carbon ceramics are designed to operate in a very, very high temperature situation with extremely high pressures. So because of that, they had to be made out of a material that's much stronger and harder. That's why they, you know, dealers advertise carbon ceramics as being lifetime rotors or very low brake dust, because they just don't get used up. So where does the squeaking come in? Well, when you brake on the street, you don't get them up to the temperature that they're designed to operate. They're designed to be braking hard on every corner and getting very hot. And so because they don't get that hot, they don't actually burn up. That's where the no dust comes from. And when they don't burn up, you have a pad layer, that top layer that touches the rotor, that goes through what's called a low heat cycle. In some cases, we use it to do heat hardening. So like on a ring gear or pinion, the outer teeth are heated on these heat cycles that are not hot enough to destroy them, but hot enough to raise the tensile strength. And that's the amount of force it takes to snap something. The only drawback to raising tensile strength is that when you get too many heat cycles or you get the tensile strength too high, when it does break, it shatters. If you go to the dealer and you tell them my brakes are squeaking really badly, what they do is, one of my favorite jobs when I was at the dealer, is they give you the car to the tech and they say, hey man, brakes squeak. And we go out and just drive it hard and get the brakes hot. And that way, it actually burns off that brittle layer. And then we give it back to the client, be like, oh yeah, we had to clean the brakes. Which technically we did, and cleaned off that top layer. But in 6 months, they'll come back with the same problem. Because again, they're gonna drive it slow, baby it, build up that heat layer, and then have the same problem. So how do you get this squeal to go away without going and losing your car for a few days and paying the dealer whatever they charge you? Go somewhere where you have an empty freeway, and that's kind of hard in LA, I know, but if you go late at night or super early in the morning, put your flashers on and make sure it's a good straight freeway, and then get up to 80 miles an hour and then hard brake down to 30 miles an hour. You need to make sure that there's no one behind you that's gonna slam into you, but you do this and then immediately accelerate back to 80 miles an hour. You're supposed to apply near ABS point of brake pressure. So you need to brake really hard to where, not so much that you are using the ABS system, but just below that point. And then you're gonna do this 80 to 30, accelerate immediately to 80 to 30, 6 to 10 times. Depending on how long it's been since your brake pads got hot. And then after you do that, you need to cruise at about 60, 70 or above miles per hour for at least 5 minutes to allow them to cool down. If you do this process and then immediately get off the freeway and sit at a stop sign with your foot on the brake, you're gonna melt the pads into the rotor. If you do have to stop for some reason, try to pop it into neutral and take your feet off the brake, or potentially use a handbrake if it's a manual pull handbrake. Okay, so now that you know how to make it go away by wearing off that layer, does that make you think about something with the rotors possibly? I know a lot of people think that these rotors are lifetime rotors. You see it all over the internet, Daily Driven Exotics forum. Everybody thinks the rotors last forever. But do they actually? I mean, we haven't seen them failing because they are very tough rotors. And again, it's a relatively new technology, only about 20 years. And on the cars that came equipped with them that long ago, most of those cars that still are around are being babied to help their resale values. So we're not seeing them being pushed hard. But does that mean they won't fail? Well, first, let's talk about how the dealer used to measure health of the rotor. On the rotor, you'll see, like on this Lamborghini Urus here, a minimum thickness. So that's just like a steel rotor. As it wears away, it gets thinner
and that's when you replace it. But if the brakes are never getting hot and they're never being worn away, does that mean that you could have a rotor that passes that test but is still compromised? Well, there's another test that dealers do. We did at Lamborghini when I was there, and Bugatti and Aston Martin still do. And it's a weight change on the rotor. You'll see a minimum weight in grams, and you're supposed to remove the rotor from the hub and clean it thoroughly, and then even bake it just to make sure that you have no impurities left on the rotor. And then you weigh it on a very fine measurement scale. And if it's below a minimum weight, then again, it's a bad rotor. But again, if the rotor's not really being used, does that mean it could pass that test and still be compromised? The third way of measuring a rotor that dealers use is one used by Ferrari. In the Ferrari repair manual, it says that if the appearance is like this, you need to replace it, showing this type of rotor. There's also an algorithm in the Ferrari computer that calculates the wear based on the way that you've been driving it and the age, and gives you a scientific guess on when that rotor would be bad. But is it possible that that is not even accurate? Well, I thought of this and I started doing some research. Brembo also thought of this, and they determined, just like I had, that something might not be right with the way we've been measuring the health of these rotors. They approached a company in France named Prosec, who are known for very fine measurement tools. They use the ultrasonic tools that measure the aircraft turbine blades ultrasonically to make sure they're not developing cracks, so we don't have blowing up engines, as you might have seen before. They also use other tools to detect radiation shielding in nuclear power equipment. And they were put to the task to determine how to tell if the carbon ceramic rotors were going bad. And so they did. They came out with a tool named the Carbotech. Now this tool, it inducts an electrical current within the tool that then sends out magnetic waves that go into the rotor. And they interact with the material in the rotor. And if it's conductive, a magnetic wave passing over a conductive material will induce a current in that conductive material, or the rotor, which then in turn will produce its own magnetic waves, which then the tool reads that interaction and tells you how conductive the rotors are. Now, why is this important? As carbon silicate, which is what the carbon ceramic brakes are made of, starts to deteriorate and oxidize, it turns to a carbon graphite. And maybe you've heard of graphite before. It's that stuff in your pencil, you know, the stuff that when you push really hard, it just shatters. Obviously, we don't want that in the brakes, and that's what this tool does. Every rotor made by Brembo from 2017 to present has a calibration mark every 120 degrees around the rotor. That calibration mark has two numbers. On the left, the from new number, and on the right, the minimum rating number. And what you do is you line up your Prosec tool laser with the line in between the two numbers, and you take the measurement, and that gives you the current health of the rotor. Audi has put out a technical service bulletin saying that this is the only way to accurately measure the health of the rotor. Basically, what this means is what I'm telling you about the heat hardening of the rotor is an accurate description of deterioration. It's the catalyst causing these rotors to wear, and it's not showing it by the old thickness, weight, or possibly Ferrari algorithm. I called Audi Beverly Hills to see if I could have some rotors tested and they could show me their tool. This tool is $7,000 tool, so it's very expensive. I'm saving up for it. I want to get it. I'm being upfront with my clients that I don't have it and that this is the only way to test it. But guess what? Audi Beverly Hills doesn't have the tool. They told me they were going to measure the weight. I called Aston Martin and Lamborghini and Bugatti even. They don't have the tool, nor had they even, the technicians even heard of it. I did find one dealership that does stock the tool, and they've asked me not to tell who it is because they don't want everyone bringing their carbon ceramic rotors there to get tested. They'll only do it on their own clients' cars. It is a major dealer. I'm very proud of them for stocking it and very grateful that they allowed me to go in and see the tool and its operation. I appreciate it, but we need to get this tool in shops. This is a life or death matter. If you're trying to come to a stop, or you're driving a car, or let's say you sell the car to someone who wants to really drive it, and they drive it really hard and get the brakes to their operating temperature, and they are no longer a good carbon ceramic rotor, they could shatter and cause injury, millions of dollars of property damage, or, you know, worst case scenario, it could take someone's life. This is something that we need to talk about, and it needs to be at every dealership and every shop that's giving you a guarantee on your brake. So are we seeing these rotors fail with this new tool? I talked to the tech at the dealership that has the tool, and they said, no, we'll never see the brakes failing under this tool because the cars that have carbon ceramics are never driven that hard. But see, that just, again, proves that he didn't quite understand the purpose of the tool. It's not about how hard you drive them. It's about these low heat cycle failures. And my prediction is in the next 3 years, once we have 6-7 years worth of life on some rotors, they're going to be failing. And at that point, you're going to hear DDE say, this is just a gimmick to sell you rotors. You don't need them. But they don't know what they're talking about. And I'm going to tell you what, the car that we tested them on, that they were very gracious enough to show me, had 2 years of age and 2,000 miles on it. And the from new rating was 61. And the minimum allowable was 39, and this one read a 57, meaning it had gone down 4 points. And now the difference of those two numbers is 22 points of a total amount of wear allowed. So 4 of 22 is basically 18% of the wear already, even though it had extremely low miles and low age. So I think this wear is happening, and it's a big threat to possibly your safety.